So, as we have considered the effect of winding resistance, okay, by showing resistance on primary and secondary, and in the next point we said that we are going to consider the effect of leakage flux. So it means the leakage flux is occurring on both primary side as well as on the secondary side. So your leakage EMF EL1 and EL2, it is dependent upon X1 and X2. So in order to represent the concept of leakage EMF, okay, in order to highlight the concept of this leakage EMF, we indicate some reactants on primary side as X1 and some reactants on secondary side as the X2. Some reactants on secondary side as the X2. Understanding? Is it clear to you? Then, next is ion losses in the core. The last point is ion losses in the core. Now, since we know that the core, it is made up of a magnetic material, okay, and there exist two kinds of losses in the core. One, it is said to be as an hysteresis loss. One more, it is said to be as an eddy current loss. So what is this hysteresis loss? What is this eddy current loss? So this we will be discussing during discussion on losses in a transformer. Okay, we'll be discussing more in detail about losses in a transformer. So it is our next concept. So at that time we'll go something in detail. So as of now, you have to just understand that the core is made up of magnetic material, to be more specific, a silicon steel, right? Then next, there exist two kinds of losses in the core. One is called as hysteresis loss, one more it is called as the eddy current loss. So both these losses, they are dependent upon the maximum field density, BF, maximum field density or maximum flux density. Then it is dependent upon frequency, volume. So these are all the parameters, and also I can say thickness of the, or it just covers in the term as volume. So these are all the parameters which influence. These are all the parameters which influence the losses in the core or the losses in the magnetic material. Okay. So normally, since this BM, F, and V, these are all the constant parameters, so they don't vary. So since this magnetic loss is dependent on Vm, F and V, where this Vm, F and V are constant, magnetic losses are also called as a constant loss. Magnetic losses are also called as constant losses or fixed losses. They're also called as fixed losses. Understanding? Now I would like to ask some questions to you, so that let me have a feedback whether you are able to understand this diagrammatic representation of your particle transformer. Now I would like to know that why are you writing R1 on the primary side? What is this indicating? Yes, please answer me in the group chat. Why you are writing this R1? Yes. Yes, internal resistance of whom? Of primary winding. Very good. So R1 is indicating internal resistance of primary winding. Very good. What about R2? Why you are writing this R2? What is this indicating? Why are you writing this R2? It's the internal resistance of secondary winding. Excellent. Good. Then what is the significance of this X1? Why are you representing this X1? When you just draw a coil and represent X1, what does this X1 is indicating? Yes, it is talking about leakage reactance. Very good. It's a keyword. This X1 is indicating the primary leakage reactance. Very good. What about this X2? What is this X2 indicating? Yes, what is this X2 indicating? A secondary leakage reactance. As you know that there is a leakage flux on primary side and secondary side. So effect of that will be having some leakage EMFs, EL1 and EL2. So EL1 and EL2, they are dependent upon X1 and X2. And hence, we are representing X1 and X2 on both primary side as well as secondary side respectively. Okay, good, very good. So it means now we are able to understand how we are developing the circuit, because one should know how the transition is happening in my transformer from this ideal case to this practical case. Okay, one should know the significance of each component. So each component represented here is having one concept behind it. So the same thing we have represented over here, right? Okay, good. So now we will build the phasor diagram for this particular circuit. Okay, that's transformer on load condition. Okay, transformer on load condition. So now in case of transformer, before going for transformer on load, let me say that I'm not having any load onto my secondary. Let me not make you confused. So in this representation, I have shown some load, right? So let me say that my transformer is on no load. So this load is not there. Okay. So for your easiness, I'll build this circuit once again. Okay. Now let me say that I'm having the magnetic core. Okay. So I'll be having the primary winding, then the secondary winding. So this resistance is being shown over here. This is the reactance. So R1, X1, then supply voltage. Similarly, I'll be having R2, then the X2. So this is open. There is some flux. The current that flows to this, the primary winding. So I can call this current as, the primary current. Am I right? I can call this current as the primary current. The primary current produces the flux. Part of the flux links with itself. The remaining flux links with the secondary. There exists one more flux which links with secondary itself. Yes or no? So this is your phi L1, leakage flux. This is your phi L2. Am I right? Then this is your E1, induced EMF on primary side. This is E2, induced EMF on secondary side. Okay, so this is your V2, terminal voltage or load voltage. Since your circuit is open, your current I2 is equals to zero because the resistance is infinite here. Am I right? Okay, then. So this flux we called it as a working flux, phi W. So I hope we are able to cover all the parameters what we have discussed. Okay, so now, so in order to build the phasor diagram for this, now first thing, again, what you have to do is, you have to identify a common parameter which is there between the primary winding and secondary winding. So once again, we'll be having flux as the common parameter. So working flux phi is a common parameter between both primary winding and secondary winding. Okay, so as this, in the previous case, that's in the ideal case, I was having some magnetizing current, I mu. So which was responsible for the production of the flux in the circuit. So even in this case, there is some I mu which is held responsible for producing some magnetizing current or to producing the flux in the magnetic circuit. Now, I'll be having the no load current in the circuit. No load current means current which is drawn on the primary side when there is no load on the secondary. Okay, so this current, whatever I1 is there, this current I1, I call it as I0. Okay, so this whatever current I1 is there, now I'll be calling it as I0. What is I0? I0 is said to be as an no load current. Okay, I0 is said to be as an no load current. Okay, I0 is said to be as an no load current. Now, I can simply say that, now since this I mu is representing what? It is representing the amount of current which is required to product, which is required to produce a flux and link from primary to secondary. Am I right? Then next I'll be having one more component which is called as a working component. Okay, That working component is shown over here as I omega or IW. The resultant of these two, if I take a parallelogram law, if I take a resultant of these two, this gives me my no load current I0. Understanding? Then next is what? Next is with respect to the supply voltage V1. How is the supply voltage V1? So again, with respect to the flux phi, the supply voltage V1 will be having an angle 90 degree. So this is V1, right? Then next, what about the induced EMF E1, E2? Induced EMF E1 and E2, they has to be in phase opposition. So we represent, assuming that this is a step up transformer, so potential on secondary will be, or EMF induced on the secondary will be greater than that of EMF induced on the primary. And whatever is the secondary voltage, that is the induced EMF on secondary, same will be the terminal voltage because load is not connected. So your E2 will be equal to your V2. Okay? So as we are not connecting any load onto this secondary, the secondary copper losses are neglected. So secondary copper losses means what? Current flowing through the resistance, I square R loss. So this I square R loss, it is zero because I2 itself is zero. Okay. And over here, there exists some small copper loss, which is nothing but I0 square into R1. So since the value of I0 will be very small, this copper loss can be neglected on the primary side when transformer is on no load. Is it clear to you? So this is the complete phasor diagram which illustrates the transformer on no load condition, Now, if I want to compute this I mu value and I omega value, how to do it? So as you know that this is a simple right angle triangle. If I want the magnitude of I mu, okay, because this is an angle theta. For me, so since this is angle theta, if I take adjacent side, even this becomes angle theta. And in order to compute this I mu, which is nothing but the length of this on x-axis, then I can simply use the Pythagoras theorem, and I can state that my I mu can be given by I naught, which is the resultant vector, into sine phi naught. Then in order to compute this I omega, how I can write this? I omega can be given by I naught cos phi naught. Then I can simply say that the power which is being consumed on the primary side or on a no load condition, so input power at no load condition, don't feel this is output power. So this naught is indicating no load condition. So power at no load condition is nothing but V naught, or I can say that V1, the supply voltage, into I naught cos phi naught. Okay, V1 I naught cos phi naught. So this is the power which is being consumed by your transformer or primary side of a transformer at no load condition, when there is no load onto the transformer. Understanding? I hope your people are able to understand this, how I am writing this equation. Now, since I want I mu, right? How I can get I mu? If I write as sine theta, because sine theta is defined as opposite side by hypotenuse. Opposite is I mu, hypotenuse is I naught. Then you write it for I mu. So I mu will be equal to I naught sine phi naught. Now, how to write for I omega? So this I omega, so this is same as that of this vector. Am I right? So even this is also I W or I omega. So if at all if I want this, then this is my adjacent side. Since this is adjacent side, I have to write cos theta. So cos theta has been defined as adjacent side divided by hypotenuse. Then adjacent side will be equal to hypotenuse into cos theta. So this is what the simple concept I'm using it. So this you have studied it even in case of a single phase circuits. Okay, is it clear to you? Okay. Any doubts in the topic that we discussed? Yes. Any doubts in the topics that we have discussed?